All right. Now, last week, I sketched for you the events leading up to Jesus' crucifixion, and when I was so rudely interrupted by the bell. I don't know what happened. Sometimes I don't hear that first bell. But when I was so rudely interrupted by the bell, Pilate, he had relented to the pressure from the Jewish leaders and had Jesus. He had sentenced him to be crucified. And Jesus was scourged as this brutal prelude to crucifixion, where they would basically just whip the skin off your back with the thongs that had metal and bone in them. And he's then marched off to Golgotha to be crucified. And at some point, a man named Simon of Cyrene was conscripted to carry Jesus' cross, which probably means the cross beam. And that would have weighed 30 to 40 pounds. Presumably, he was conscripted to do that because Jesus was too weak from what he'd been through. Jesus was crucified between two robbers or insurrectionists. That is, traditionally, they've been translated thieves, which I don't think really captures the idea, but that's so, you know, that's so in there that you're not going to buck that translation. But he gets crucified between them under the charge, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. And the mocking of him continues by soldiers, by leaders, by people who are passing by. Even the robbers are reviling Jesus. But one of the robbers has a change of heart, and Jesus tells him, "Today you will be with me in paradise." The crucifying soldiers, they cast lots for Jesus' clothes. They're going to divvy him up. I mean, he's dead. You know, he'll be dead. We're going to take his clothes. And so they cast lots, which is, of course, in fulfillment of prophecy. Now, as the late New Testament scholar John Wenham pieces things together in his book, Easter Enigma, okay, which admittedly it involves a fair amount of speculation, but it's reasonable speculation. But you know that as you read the accounts, there's something about piecing them together because people will say different aspects of it. And so Wenham's book, Easter Enigma, he works to try to put things into a whole. And as I say, there's some speculation in it, but it's reasonable speculation. But as he pieces things together, it seems that early in the crucifixion, the Virgin Mary, of course, that's the Lord's mother, the Virgin Mary, Mary Magdalene, who is possibly Martha's sister Mary. Now, that may sound odd, but that's the position that Wenham takes, and he argues for that, but not a great deal hinges on it. But I just throw that out for your thought. But you have the Virgin Mary, you have Mary Magdalene, you have Mary, the wife of Clopas, Salome, and John. At the early on, they're allowed by the centurion to come near to the cross, and you have other relatives and well-wishers, which would probably include Joanna and Susanna, the wealthy women who had been with Jesus. They're at a distance at the beginning. Now, I wanted to just very quickly, because I have so much to get through and I don't want to run out of time again, so I'm talking fast. I always talk fast, but today especially. But I'm going to do this. I want to just real quickly show you the relationships here. So we're Friday afternoon. This is the crucifixion. Friday morning to late afternoon. I'll go through this. But here you have the three women that are named at the crucifixion in addition to Mary, the Lord's mother. And you see here in Matthew, Mark, and John, you have the Mary Magdalene, Mary Magdalene, Mary Magdalene, all clear. Number three is Mary, the mother of James and Joseph. Mary, the mother of James the younger and Joseph, which is another way of doing Joseph. The other Mary, Mary, the mother of James. So clearly, and then John has Mary, the wife of Clopas. So it looks pretty clear we've got Mary Magdalene. We've got Mary, the mother of James the younger and Joseph. James the younger is probably the apostle James, by the way. The other, you know, where you have here the other one. Yeah, so the son of Alphaeus, and that raises other questions. But and then you have Mary, the wife of Clopas. So we have Mary Magdalene, Mary, the wife of Clopas, who's the mother of James and Joseph. And then the other one, the second one, is called different things. You have the mother of the sons of Zebedee, Salome, and Jesus' mother's sister. So when you put these together, you see Salome Okay, you have her, Zebedee. She's the mother of James and John, sons of Zebedee. And then you have, she's the sister of Mary. And when you look over here, the other Mary, this is Mary, who's wife of Clopas, and the mother of James, the younger, Joseph of Joseph. Okay, so these are the women who were here at the cross nearby, right very early on. And then Jesus, from the cross, he commits his mother to John's care. He commits his mother to John's care, and then, as Wenham speculates, John and his mother, Salome, then take Mary, John's new mother, to a home that they have in Jerusalem. Now you say, I never heard of a home of John in Jerusalem. Well, Wenham speculates that because of the fishing business they had, and there are a number of other pieces of this, John's familiarity with Jerusalem, the fact he's known to the high priest, he speculates that they had a place to stay in Jerusalem. So he says here, Jesus says to John, behold your mother. John and his mother Salome then take Mary to a place they have in Jerusalem. And it seems that the three women, they were supporting the Lord's mother Mary by the cross up there close until the time that he says, behold your mother, and John and Salome then take her. And then they move back to observe the Lord's suffering at a distance. And you say, what's all this? All of this movement and things are going in seeing different aspects of the Gospels. And this is how he's putting them together. And I just want you to see they do go together. Okay, and you can argue about different things. As I say, there's a fair amount of speculation here, but they do fit. Okay, whether this is the precise fit or not, it is a possible fit. And so then they move back. Now, darkness fell on the land for about 3 hours, but John returns. He stays with Mary, his new mother, at this place in Jerusalem for a while, perhaps a couple of hours. And then he returned to the crucifixion, and John was there witnessing the end. And there's a darkness that comes over the land for about 3 hours. And then Jesus declared, it is finished. And he gave his life up. See, his life wasn't taken from him by force. He gave his life up. And this would be April 7th if the year is AD 30. Now, as I said, some people think it's AD 33. Most, I think, would say 30. And if that's correct, then we're looking here on April 7th, AD 30. Jesus dies, there's an earthquake, and the curtain in the temple, the curtain that separated the holy place from the most holy place, is ripped in two, rocks were split, and tombs were broken open. Now that's telling you this is something significant that's going on. When God intervenes in this way with darkness, with an earthquake, with rocks being shattered, this is God saying, big business here. And so this happens. And after Jesus' death, the soldiers, of course, pierced his side with a spear, releasing a flow of water and blood. Then Joseph of Arimathea, who was a wealthy person, Joseph of Arimathea gets permission to bury Jesus, and he wraps his body in a linen shroud and took it to his newly cut tomb that was nearby. So he wraps it in a shroud, takes it to this newly cut tomb, and then given that the Sabbath began at sundown, there wasn't sufficient time to adequately prepare the body. Because we're getting in the late afternoon, and sundown begins the Sabbath and the Passover Sabbath. So, you know, they want to not be doing this, can't be doing this when the Sabbath begins. So there's not that much time. So Joseph and Nicodemus, they temporarily pack the body in a large supply of spices. Now, to all the world, it looks like Rome has crushed another pretender to authority. This isn't the first person Rome has crucified and killed who has popped up and been deemed a threat to Roman rule. I mean, they kill you. You come up and you gather people around you and you're making a hubbub, and okay, they come in and they kill you. And then that goes away. Well, what happened? Well, he's dead. Well, his followers disband. Why? Because he's dead. And so it looked to all the world that this was just another in a line of Roman assertion of dominance and power, that we have killed this pretender to authority. But as the saying goes, Sunday's coming. You see, and that's the way it looked to the world. Well, Joanna, whose husband Cusa was a steward to Herod Antipas. Okay, he's somebody in his court, somebody who's an official in his household. You have Joanna, whose husband's a steward in Herod Antipas's house, and Susanna, who's another well-to-do woman who's mentioned with Joanna in Luke chapter 8, verse 3. So they're apparently running buddies, both with means, both with money. And so they perhaps followed Joseph into the tomb and helped lay out the body. Now, it seems pretty clear that somebody got pretty much in there, because in Luke 23, 55, it says the women saw how the body was laid. So that's the kind of thing, see, that then Wenham then speculates, okay, so I'm thinking Joanna and Susanna were the two who go into the body. Joanna, being upper crust, would have probably known the wealthy Joseph of Arimathea. You see, so they go in and they see how the body's laid, and then Mary Magdalene and Mary of Clopas watch at a respectful distance. And that all fits with different pieces. So they go and see how the body's laid. Mary Magdalene, Mary of Clopas are there, but they're at a respectful distance. And then the four women conferred, and they agreed to return at first light on Sunday to anoint the body as best they could. That's first light after the Sabbath, right? Sabbath from Friday evening, all day Saturday, it ends, but then it's dark Sunday, and you got to come up here and say, okay, first light Sunday. They agree, we're going to return, and we're going to anoint the body as best we can. You know, so that they were thinking, apparently, that the body had been insufficiently prepared because of the lack of time. It had simply been temporarily packed in these spices, and that wasn't adequate. So they get together and say, okay, first light, we're going to return. Now, before leaving, they see Joseph's servants roll this great stone up against the entrance of the tomb. This served a number of purposes, one of which was to protect the body from carnivores, animals that would come out and eat them. So you're going to be in that tomb with a body. They're going to block it. And so they watch that. They know where the tomb is very well. And they watch this stone get rolled up against there. Now, Saturday is the Sabbath. Saturday during the day, right? Starts at sundown. And then all during the day till sundown of Saturday is the Sabbath. Well, the members of the Sanhedrin, they send a delegation of Pharisees and Sadducees to Pilate to procure guards for the tomb. Now, presumably, they have some temple guards there, but they want to go and get from Pilate some Roman soldiers to secure this tomb. And they succeeded in that, and the tomb was sealed. And then the temple guard, backed up by a contingent of Roman soldiers, they then set up a watch. So the tomb is sealed. Jesus is in there. They're setting up a watch. And then that evening, after the Sabbath ends, because it's from Friday evening to Saturday evening, that evening of Saturday, which would be the beginning of their Sunday, that evening after the Sabbath had ended, you have Mary Magdalene, Mary of Clopas, and Salome. They bought spices for the anointing. Now, before, you see, Joanna and Susanna had returned, presumably, to the Hasmonean palace, because Joanna's husband is a steward of Herod Antipas, and that's where he'd be staying. They returned there and prepared spices and ointments from what they had on hand. You see, because this is a wealthy place. This is a palace. So they were able to prepare the spices and ointments from what they had on hand. And this is probably in the space they had before the Sabbath begins. So then we had the Sabbath beginning. And Mary Magdalene and Mary of Clopas, they then go to John's house. Okay? I'm back here with the afternoon. We've got Joanna and Susanna go prepare spices. Mary Magdalene and Mary of Clopas this is speculation, go to John's house, it being too close to the Sabbath for Mary Magdalene to return to Bethany. Now, if Mary Magdalene is in fact Martha's sister Mary, you'd understand why she's going to Bethany. But if she's not, then perhaps she's staying in Bethany. That's where they'd been, remember, when they're coming from Bethany and they're coming to Jerusalem, and then they would go back to Bethany. That's where they were hanging out. And so this happens, and then Sabbath, I had to back up there because I missed something I wanted to say. Then we have them go and they secure the tomb, and then that evening, which is, the Sabbath is over, we then have the Marys go in, Mary Magdalene, Mary of Clopas, and Salome. They went and bought spices for the anointing. Why do I say that? Because you have a reference to women preparing spices and women buying spices. So what Wenham thinks is that, listen, it would make sense if Joanna and Susanna are the ones who go back to the Hasmonean palace and they prepare the spices because they already have the stuff on hand. But clearly some of the women bought spices. And so after the Sabbath is over, we have Salome, Mary Magdalene, Mary of Clopas. They buy the spices. Now, perhaps Salome is the one who actually is the agent of all three and is the one who does the actual purchasing on behalf of all three, while Mary Magdalene and Mary of Clopas, accompanied, of course, by Clopas, her husband, because it's now dark, right? We're in Saturday evening, night. They go to Bethany. Why would they go there? They would go there to tell the other disciples about the horrible news. You see, they had stayed away. Only Peter and John are in Jerusalem. Where are the other guys? Well, presumably they're in Bethany. And so it would make sense they would go there to report to these other disciples what had happened. Our Lord is dead. He's dead. He was crucified, killed, and now he's in a tomb. So this would have been dreadful news indeed. Now we come to before dawn on Sunday. Still darkness. While it's still dark, Mary Magdalene and Mary of Clopas, of course accompanied by Clopas, it's still dark, they now return from Bethany. They'd gone to Bethany to let the other disciples know what had happened. So they now return from Bethany. They set out from there to return to John's house. They go to John's house. Clopas, the husband of Mary, he stays there while Salome, Mary Magdalene, and Mary of Clopas, they then went to the tomb at daybreak. Why? To anoint the body, as they had talked about. Because they had felt that the body had been insufficiently prepared, so they go at daybreak. First light on Sunday, they're going to go. They're going to anoint the body. So they have come from Bethany, the two of them. They come to John's place. Clopas stays there, and the three women head to the tomb at daybreak to anoint the body. Now, there's an earthquake, and an angel rolled the gravestone away. Now, this is not to let the body out. This is to let the witnesses come into the tomb to verify that it's empty, that his body is gone. He has, in fact, come out of the tomb. So you have the angel who does this, and the angel sat on top of the stone, and as Wenham interprets it, frightened the guards away. They were clearly freaked out. But Wenham then takes it a step and says, okay, they were freaked out and terrified, and they left because they were so afraid. And so this happens, and then the angel then withdrew into the tomb so as not to frighten the women when they arrived. So rolls it away, sits there, flips out the guards. They leave. Here come the women. He's in the tomb so as not to frighten them when the women arrive. Now, Matthew 28, 2 and 4 is probably intended by Matthew for he probably intends his readers to understand that those events happened while the women were on the way, not after the women got there. Now, it's ambiguous, I grant that. But this idea, I think, of their appearing and all of that in 28, 2 to 4, is something that is intended to be understood as happened while they're on the way. The guards are frightened off. The women arrive. The angel is in the tomb so as not to frighten them off. Now, the Jewish guards, they wound up encouraging the senior soldiers to first go with them to their authorities. Because they're thinking, listen, we think that Caiaphas might be able to act as a buffer for you between with Pilate. So they encourage those Roman guards to go with them to their officials. And when the women arrived at the tomb, they saw that the gravestone had been rolled away. Well, the angel had rolled it away before he, you know, scared them off, goes back in. They get there and the tomb's open. It's been rolled away. And Mary Magdalene, it seems, jumps to the conclusion that somebody has stolen the body, and she then just bolts and runs to tell Peter and John. Somebody's stolen the body. And she just takes off. So we have then Salome and Mary of Clopas. They're there considering what to do. And you can see, I mean, this would be kind of an, you know, you're coming to anoint this body. This was your plan. You get there and the tomb's open. And so they're, while they're there contemplating or considering what to do, Joanna and Susanna arrive. Okay, having come as agreed to complete the burial rites. You remember the four of them? As Wyndham reconstructs this, they were there. They said, we'll come at first light. Joanne and Susanna are somewhere else. They're at their Hasmonean palace. So we've got the women come from Bethany. They go to John's house. The three of them come there. Mary Magdalene takes off. Those two are waiting. Joanne and Susanna then join them as agreed. And so there they are. And then Joanna leads the group into the tomb to verify that the body was in fact missing. So into the tomb, looking. And the angel then makes, the angels made themselves visible, and that's when they deliver the message to the women that he has risen. He's risen. The one you're seeking is alive. Now you go and tell the disciples. So they get this message, and then led by Joanna, they then rush back into the city and headed for John's house. Well, they understood that the people would be. But then we have Peter and John, who had heard from Mary Magdalene, who when she saw the open tomb just ran and said, somebody stolen the body, ran back to tell Peter and John. They get the word from Mary Magdalene. They hear this, and then they run to the tomb with Mary Magdalene trailing behind. Because these guys are booking. You see, so they then run to the tomb, and having heard that, and Joanna, whether it's because she's less familiar with the city or just a matter of choice, then she takes a less direct route from the tomb to John's house. They're going from John's house to the tomb, Peter and John, with Mary Magdalene trailing behind. Joanna and the women who've gotten the message from the angels are coming from the tomb to John's house. And yet their paths don't cross. You say, how could that be? Well, it'd be just like if somebody went upstairs here. You know, I'm going to go up there. Somebody comes down and I go up the other stairway. Well, you can see how that would happen. If somebody takes a less direct route, they wouldn't have to run into each other. So you have Mary, Peter and John run there and they see the empty tomb, but the angels didn't make themselves visible. I would just find that interesting. By the way, I was telling Meg, do you see women are all over this thing? It's very interesting. You got the Virgin Mary, Mary Magdalene. You see, Mary of Clopas, Salome, Joanna, Susanna, they're all over it. And so Peter and John go there. They see what they see in the tomb, but the angels didn't make themselves visible. And then Mary Magdalene, she lingers behind after Peter and John saw what they saw and they returned home. But she's there, just kind of perplexed and wondering what in the world is going on. And she saw the angels in the tomb, and then Jesus appeared to her, first to Mary Magdalene. Jesus appears to her first, to Mary Magdalene. And she then returns to John's house, where she finds a group of excited women, the women who had gone into the tomb and been told by the angel, he's risen, go and tell the disciples. They are now back at the house. Peter and John have been to the tomb, saw what they saw. They come back. Mary Magdalene, he's appeared to her. She then returns, so they're all at the house. And she finds this group of women who are excited and a group of confused and somewhat skeptical men. And Salome and Mary of Clopas, perhaps headed to Bethany. And why would they do that? Because the angel had said, go and tell the disciples. Okay, well, nine of the disciples are in Bethany. So I think this, you know, as Wyndham reconstructs it, as they start out to Bethany, this is when the Lord appears to them. Because this splits up the appearance to Mary Magdalene and this appearance to the, another appearance to the women. So this is as they begin on the road, heading out to Bethany. Remember, it's just 2 miles away. Even I can walk that. It's 2 miles away. They head out there. They're met by Jesus. And then Clopas and his companion set out for Emmaus. Now, Luke uses the name Cleopas, you see, instead of Clopas. We say, is that something significant? Well, it may be for a Greek audience, instead of simply transliterating the name Clopas, that Cleopas was a well-known Greek name. So maybe he said, that's close enough. I'm just going to use Cleopas. You know, it would be like if you had a name, rather than transliterate it, that name is so close to that, I'll just use that Greek name. And so we wind up having Clopas and his companion, they set out for Emmaus. And then Jesus, you recall, joined them and made himself known at the midday meal. And then during the afternoon, Jesus appeared to Peter. And that's kind of, you know, you say, well, where does that happen? That's in Luke 24:34, where it's just a reference. The Lord has appeared to Peter. We don't get the description of it. We have a reference to it. So then we have in that afternoon, he appears. The apostles from Bethany, okay, remember, somebody's gone and said, what's up, and gone to Bethany. The apostles, those who were there from Bethany, they then come, less Thomas. Okay, Thomas isn't with them. So we just have eight of them coming. And they arrived and they gathered with the others in the upper room. Now the upper room, this is apparently the house of John's mother, John Mark, you know, Mark's mother, who happens also to be named Mary. You can see there are a lot of Marys. As I remember Jack Lewis said one time, he was in whatever it was, first grade or fifth grade, and he said he had five Jacks in that class. So, but this is the upper room. This isn't John's place. John's place is presumably a smaller place, if you accept Wyndham's speculation about that. The upper room is going to be this larger house that belongs to Mark's mother, and you can see that in Acts chapter 12, verse 12, that she's the owner there. So it's Mark's families. They gather in this upper room, and then Clopas and his companion, they return from Emmaus, and they join them. So now we have the apostles who've come from Bethany, less Thomas. We've got Peter and John. We've got Clopas and his companion. We've got other people in this large upper room. And there Jesus, it is this group appearance that he makes to them. He appears to the 10 apostles and to the others. And then note that also the bodies of older saints, saints who had died, you know, long ago, the bodies of other saints, holy ones, God's faithful people who had died, they came out of their tombs after the Lord's resurrection and appeared to many people in Jerusalem. Now, there are punctuation issues. Some translations punctuate it as though they came out and were resurrected prior to Jesus. That's not the right way to understand it. And the English Standard Version and many other translations get the punctuation correct, and it is that they come out after Christ's resurrection. And that's in Matthew 27:52-53. Now, that's the only place that's mentioned. And we have a lot of questions about that. Precisely who are the people? Are they resuscitated, truly resurrected? I think they're truly resurrected. And I think what this is, it's a foretaste of what will happen to all when the Lord returns, even those who'd live before the Lord's coming. Right? That's what's going on here, I think. But it's just you get the statement, and that's all you get. And you're going, yeah, but what about this? What about that? But there it is. You have people, these saints who had died previously after the Lord's resurrection. It shows you the impact of the Lord's resurrection on bodies. You see, they come out of the tomb. And this is something that's going to happen to all. Now we get to the following Sunday, so we're a week down now, April 16th. The following Sunday, Jesus appeared to the 11. Now Thomas has joined them. Remember the first visit there? He wasn't there. Now we have Thomas, and he joins him while they're meeting in the house. And then we have later appearances in Galilee. You remember he says, go and tell them to go into Galilee. And so after we have the Passover festival completed, which includes the Feast of Unleavened Bread, that week-long feast, after that is concluded, the 11 return to their home country of Galilee pursuant to Christ's instruction. He said, go to Galilee. And so after that festival's over, they go to Galilee, and then Jesus appears to 7 of the apostles as they're fishing on the Sea of Galilee. And you know the story. I can't go through all these, but he appears to them there while they're fishing on the Sea of Galilee, and then he appeared to more than 500 brothers, including the 11 disciples, at a prearranged meeting on a remote mountainside in Galilee. And you can see in 1 Corinthians 15 when Paul speaks about this. This is probably in Galilee also where he appeared to James. But he has this, that go to Galilee, he appears to the 7 there, then he appears to them on this remote mountainside, this prearranged meeting, and that may be where he gave them the great commission that's given in Matthew 28, was from this mountainside in Galilee. And then back in Jerusalem, it seems that the apostles, they're told or instructed to return to Mark's house in Jerusalem. You're going to have the Pentecost is going to be coming. But they're told apparently to return to that house in Jerusalem to wait for the final event, which was to prepare them for their world mission. And Jesus met with them there in that house and taught them the night before his ascension to heaven. And then at dawn, as dawn began, as it begins to break, Jesus then led them out of the city over the same route they'd taken the night of the Last Supper. He takes them out. He takes them up to the Mount of Olives, where the peak, and then that begins the descent down to Bethany. But he takes them out of Jerusalem, up to the summit of the Mount of Olives. He gave them his last words, and then he ascends to heaven before their eyes. Now you talk about something. You see, here he is, resurrected, no longer subject to death, resurrection body, immortal. Death no longer has mastery over him, as Paul says. And there he is, and they watch him. He goes up into heaven, and the angels tell him, this Jesus you see, he'll return in the same way you saw him go. You see, so here he goes, he ascends, and he ascends to heaven. Now, I wanted to spend some time, so you know that, and you know, there's so much that could be said about the significance of the death and resurrection. I'm just trying to give you the story, the events, okay? But now what I would like, I have in the past, the historical case for the resurrection of Christ is, it's powerful, okay? It's very powerful, and by historical case, I mean investigating whether or not the resurrection of Christ actually happened, looking into that not by relying on the inspiration of the Bible or the inerrancy of the Bible, not because we don't believe in the inspiration and inerrancy of the Bible, but because we want to see if we can discern and determine historically, did this happen without having to believe that the Bible's inspired? Can I just treat the Bible as an ancient historical document, just like any other document of the time, and still get to the truth of whether Jesus was resurrected? And you can. You can, and I'm telling you, you can get to the truth powerfully and clearly. But unfortunately, it takes me about 6 weeks to go through that. Okay? It takes about 6 weeks to get through it. So here, if you will go, the historical case for the resurrection of Christ, if you will go to that website and you will click on the link Bible studies and look up that study, there you'll have it. How I go through it. And it's powerful stuff. Okay? And then I have a little note here. Look around. If you like it, let people know about it. Okay? But I just don't have time to look into that. I wrestled with how to do this, because there's so much packed in here. I do want to say something about the views of death and the afterlife at the time of Christ. Something about that. Okay, now some in the ancient pagan world, how did people view this? You know, sometimes people say, well, you know, no big deal. These were just gullible, foolish people. They thought everybody was popping out of the ground. Yeah, so it's no big deal. I mean, so of course they did. They were ignoramuses. They hadn't observed. They hadn't been paying attention. They didn't know that when somebody died, he stayed dead. No, no, no. They thought everybody's just coming out. All right, that's just nonsense. Okay, but I want to tell you about how did people view death in the afterlife in the ancient world. Well, you have in the pagan world, you had some people who denied any kind of life after death. Okay, that would be like the worm food school. When you die, you're just dead. That's it. There's nothing that survives, nothing that goes on. You had pagans that believed that. But most pagans in the ancient world, most pagans at the time of Christ, believed that a person's spirit or soul continued to exist after death. Most of them thought that. It continued to exist. Now, those pagans who believed in a continuing spiritual existence, they did not believe in a resurrection. They did not believe in the restoration of bodily life after death. For them, death was a one-way street to a disembodied existence. They believe you continued to exist, but you continued to exist in a disembodied way. They did not believe in resurrection. They did not believe that dead people like Jesus came back to life. So you have, that was the pagan world. Now you had some Jews who reflect this. There are Jews like the Sadducees who denied there was any kind of life after death. So just like some pagans thought of the worm food school, you die, that's it. Everything's terminated. The Sadducees were in that group, but you also had some Jews like Philo who believed that one would continue to exist after death as a disembodied soul or spirit. So both of those aspects of pagan thinking were reflected among some Jews, the Sadducees and Philo. But most Jews, most ancient Jews, they believed that God would raise his people bodily from the dead on the last day, the day when he judged and remade the world. That was the conviction of most ancient Jews. I heard that first bell. First, right? Okay, all right. So that was their conviction. Now, that belief, you can see that belief, it's reflected in Martha's statement. In John chapter 11, verse 24, that she knows her dead brother Lazarus, she says, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Well, what's she talking about? She's talking about the belief that most Jews held, that the people of God would be raised bodily from the dead on the last day when God judged and remade the world. So she says, I know he's going to be raised from the dead then. And so you see that belief reflected in Martha's saying. That belief is also evident in Paul's play to the Pharisees. In Acts chapter 23, verse 6, where he says that he was on trial with respect to the hope of the resurrection of the dead. What do you think he's talking about? See, the Sadducees deny that. The Pharisees are into it. And so he pits them against them and says, that's why I'm on trial. But he refers to that Jewish conviction of a resurrection. Acts 24:15, his statement there that his accusers from Jerusalem accept the hope that there will be a resurrection of both the just and unjust. So you see it in Martha's statement, you see it in Paul. This was the typical Jewish belief. And in several places, Jesus accepts that aspect of the standard Jewish view, the aspect of a general resurrection on the last day. And you can see that, for example, in Mark 12, 18 to 27, and the parallels in Matthew and Luke. See, when the Sadducees, they ask him a trick question. And this is designed to make belief in the end time resurrection look silly, you see, because they didn't believe it. So they're trying to make it look silly. Say, all right, man, you got a guy, he's married, wife dead, you know, passed, you know, remarried seven times, resurrection. Whose wife is she? Ha. All right. So how does Jesus respond to that, you see? Jesus, he defends the belief in the end time resurrection by indicating that in that resurrection state, certain things would be different. You see, certain things, so they were assuming some things they shouldn't be assuming. Certain things would be different so that there would be no problem with people who had been married multiple times in their pre-resurrection lives. So they're trying to get him to say, that looks stupid, and he defends that belief. And you can see some other places where he recognizes that view. Now, what the Jews didn't expect, and I hope I can get this out. So that was the typical Jewish view. Yes, you had Sadducees who subscribed to the worm food school. Yes, you had Jews like Philo who thought that you continued on in a disembodied state. Most of them believed in a resurrection of the body, which is what resurrection is. Resurrection at the end when God judged and remade the world. But what they did not believe was that this end time resurrection, this rising to immortal life, would happen to someone in advance of God's world. That's what they didn't understand. They're all down for the resurrection at the end when God judges and remakes the world. But what they didn't get was the idea of the resurrection happening within history, in advance of God's remaking the world. This wasn't part of their theological landscape. They expected everybody to be raised to immortality together in conjunction with the final judgment and the beginning of the eternal state. Now, the fact that Jesus was raised contrary to that expectation, raised immortal in advance of God's remaking the world, the first fruits of the end time resurrection, it's indicated in Mark's account of the transfiguration. In Mark's account, see, when Jesus told Peter, James, and John after the transfiguration not to tell anybody what they'd seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. Now, you and I hear that and we say, that makes pretty much sense. Of course I understand what that means. Until the Son of Man had risen from the dead, Mark reports they were puzzled about what this rising from the dead might mean. Mark chapter 9, verse 9 and 10. He tells them, don't say this until the Son of Man's risen from the dead. They were puzzled about what this rising from the dead might mean. Well, what's puzzling them? What is puzzling them is outside their theological landscape is the notion that there will be a resurrection in history in advance of the end time resurrection that will be the first fruit. Oh, they're going to let me know. Last, let me read you this quote by N.T. Wright and then I'll shut up. He says, that passage in Mark flags up one of the points at which we've seen in our study of Paul a significant Christian innovation. This is Jesus' teaching where he corrected misconceptions they had. Okay? The idea that the resurrection has split into two, the now and the not yet. It is split into two with Jesus' resurrection coming forwards into the middle of history. Mark clearly intends his readers to recognize that they share with hindsight the knowledge that Jesus seemed to have in advance. The reader understands what was for the disciples at the time still a puzzle. Their mind was blown. They couldn't understand this. Mark is thus drawing our attention to the fact this is precisely an innovation within Jewish thinking. It's that. Okay? And that's what they didn't get and couldn't understand. And then when they see this resurrection in history, in time, as the first fruits, and we will participate in that. And that bell was a while ago. Thanks.